Do you own or rent your home? Sure you do. And I'll bet it can be hard work. You know what's easy? Bundling policies with GEICO. GEICO makes it easy to bundle your homeowner's or renter's insurance along with your auto policy. It's a good thing, too, because you already have so much to do around your home. Go to GEICO.com, get a quote, and see how much you could save. It's GEICO easy. Visit GEICO.com today. That's GEICO.com.
Good evening, everyone. This is Amanda Manier with the Veterans Voice here on 790 KABC. I am a veteran advocate and an attorney at the Veterans Law Group. We've worked exclusively representing veterans that have been pursuing their disability compensation for over 25 years. The Veterans Voice is a show that's all about highlighting and celebrating veterans and their families, also highlighting organizations helping veterans and just kind of providing news and answering questions about anything related to veterans in general, but specifically dealing with the VA. I would like to, if you would like to reach out to us off air, you can definitely reach us at veteranslaw.com. We do offer free consultations. Today, what I would like to do is to talk with Todd, who is a U.S. Army veteran and a veteran service officer from the great state of South Carolina. He's just going to help us give a little bit of a history as to, you know, his process of getting through the VA claims process, his experience as a veteran service officer. So I'd like to first welcome Todd.
Well, thank you, Amanda.
I really appreciate you doing this for me. You're going to have some unique insight that I think we haven't talked about yet on this show. But I would like to introduce you a little bit and do a little bit of question and answer about kind of how you got into the military, why you joined the military.
Well, it was more of a duty. I felt like it was a duty. My family served in the military all the way back into the Revolutionary War. I live in Cherokee County, South Carolina, and we have the Battle of Cathins was fought in my community, and the Battle of Kings Mountain also. And those were the turning points of the revolution for our nation, getting its independence from the British. So my family's served their country, our country, for many decades, and I just felt it was a duty. So that's kind of why I joined.
And so the majority of your family, did they pursue U.S. Army or different branches?
Just different branches. I've had my grandfather on my father's side served in the Marine Corps during World War II, and my grandfather on my mother's side served in the Navy during World War II, and I've had some uncles that served in the Army and cousins that served in different branches, but the Army kind of appealed to me since it was the oldest branch, and just felt like that I was led to join the Army.
And when did you serve? What years?
I served from 1993 to 2006.
Okay. And could you tell me a little bit about like where you served and where you served overseas?
I served in, served in Germany. But my first duty assignment was in Germany, in Bamberg, Germany. And we were deployed to Bosnia in December of 1995, and served there about 11 months. And then after my tour in Bosnia, I finished up my tour in Germany and came back to Fort Stewart, Georgia, and where I ETS'd and joined the South Carolina Army National Guard, and transferred back to civilian life part-time guardsman. And in 2003, I was called up to go to Iraq, and I went to Iraq in 2004 and 5.
So you joined prior to 9/11. We had a guest a couple of weeks ago that we were talking about that, you know, he joined the U.S. Navy at the time to get an education, travel the world, and ended up right in the middle of Iraq and Afghanistan post 9/11. So it sounds like that's what happened to you as well.
Right, right. It was, everybody was, during my time in the Guard, everybody was, if you served in the military, you were getting deployed either to Iraq or Afghanistan, either one.
And so that was relatively early on in the conflict there. Were you there for a long time? I know there's some people who served up to 18 months over there.
Yeah, I served a year in country, and total deployment time was about a year and a half, but in country in Iraq for a year.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for your service and for what you do also for, as a veteran service officer. I would like to get into a little bit about, before we get into talking about your experience as a veteran service officer, one of the things I like to find out from veterans is how much they're actually told when you were getting out. How much education were you given on like the disability claims process and your benefits in general?
Well, I mean, you go through a, you go through a class. I'm not sure what the terminology today with soldiers and sailors and Marines and airmen to go through today, but you get to an out processing program, and the VA's there and several other government agencies are there, and you go through this process and this class, and they tell you basically what you're eligible for. But in my experience, you've got one thing on your mind is to get through the class, get your paperwork signed where you can get out of there.
Definitely.
And that's just the mentality of young soldiers at the time. They're really not interested in benefits and what may, what they can get or may be entitled to. But you do a class, but most people don't pay attention. It's just to check a block and move to the next station.
Yeah, that's what I've heard a lot, that you've got a lot of boxes to check during that process of getting out, and this is just one of them. So it sounds like your experience is the same as a lot of other people that I've spoken with. I've also had a few that have talked to me that said that they were scheduled for that class, but they never actually went through it, which was interesting to me. The other thing that I've always wanted to see or would love to see the military do is allow spouses to come to those classes, as they often end up being the ones that push for the veteran to actually file their claim and go through that, or keep track of what benefits are there for the family in general versus just this is part of the checking the box. I would love to see something like that. You're listening to the Veterans Voice. You're listening to the Veterans Voice. I'm speaking with Todd, who is a U.S. Army veteran and also a veteran service officer. Go ahead, Todd.
No, I agree. It would be in a real world situation where the veteran may have a spouse, you know, including the family of the veteran in those briefings would be great. The veterans don't have a spouse typically are the ones that fall through the cracks. They just move on, find a job, go to school, and they typically don't see us for several years after the fact, after their discharge, until they start having health issues and issues that they need us to help them with.
Yeah, and we're going to kind of come back to that in one of the next segments of getting into a little bit more detail of the reasons why you've seen that people do or don't, you know, file their claims. The other thing that I see a lot is, you know, or a question that often gets asked of me is, you know, why is this process so difficult? And, you know, I definitely, you know, I work in appeals only. So essentially what that means is a veteran, for those of you who are listening, is a veteran gets out and of the service and they file a claim at some point in time. There's never a deadline as to when you can't, you know, can no longer file claims. So they file a claim for a disability that they incur, some sort of injury that they'd incurred or was aggravated while they're in service, and they get an initial decision. And then if they don't like that decision, if they were denied or underrated, there's an entire appeals process, and that's where I get involved. So I say all of that to Todd to kind of indicate that, you know, I don't see it when the VA gets it right. So I try to kind of curb my cynicism as much as possible, because typically the people who are coming to our office are people who are, you know, upset or unhappy with the decision that they're given. So I will grant the fact that there are times that the VA gets it right. But one of the things that gets asked to me all the time is, why is this process so difficult? So with the couple of minutes that we have before we reach the break here, Todd, what's kind of your perspective on that?
Well, it's fairly simple. The VA has to have three things to make your claim successful: in-service injury or illness. So there's three things the VA must have for a complete claim and you get approved: is in-service disability while on active duty, and injury or illness, and documented. then you must have a diagnosed disability today and a nexus to link those two disabilities together. So you were seen on active duty for a back injury, knee injury, or whatever it may be, or illness, and then you're still having issues today. You must have a diagnosis while on active duty and a diagnosis today. And then a doctor says the disability that you had while on active duty is the same or the residuals of the disability that you're suffering from today. It's very simple on paper, but mm-hmm. sometimes can be very difficult.
Well, what are the things that you see as
having evidence?
Yeah, what are the things that you see that typically is missing in that? Or can you give me an example of what would be missing that the VA would end up denying it?
Well, I mean, one of the biggest claims we do right today is hearing loss and tinnitus. That's mm-hmm. one of the biggest VA compensation claims that veterans put in for on a daily basis is hearing loss and tinnitus. And what happens is when they go into the military, they have a hearing exam. And depends on how long they served in the military, every 2 years, typically you have a hearing exam. And when you get out, you have a hearing exam. So what veterans do, they wait 20 and 30 and 40 years mm-hmm. after they are out of the military to file a claim for hearing and tinnitus, ringing in the ears, buzzing, humming. And there's a lot of things that happen between your military service and the time they file the claim. So my advice is, if you're having issues with hearing or tinnitus, and or tetanus, or how they pronounce it, I'm from South Carolina, so they pronounce things a little bit different, but don't wait till you completely need hearing aids before you apply for a claim. Don't wait so long to file for these claims. If you're entitled to it, we can help you get it.
Definitely. And we're coming up against a break. And what I would like to do when we come back, Todd, is to talk a little bit about that exact subject as to why people wait too long and what happens when they do. You're listening to The Veterans Voice. This is Amanda Minear with the Veterans Law Group on KABC 790. Law Group, and we are speaking this evening with Todd, who is a U.S. Army veteran and a veteran service officer from the great state of South Carolina. Todd and I have known each other for a number of years. He served as the president of the State Veteran Service Officer Association there in South Carolina. And Todd, how long have you been working as a veteran service officer?
12 years.
All right, so I'm sure you've seen quite a bit in 12 years.
Yeah, I've kind of seen a little bit of everything, I guess. The good and bad happens with the VA for sure.
Yeah, definitely. Before we went on the break, we brought up and we're talking a little bit about, you know, you were mentioning hearing loss and people waiting way too long until they actually need hearing aids and things get really bad before they actually file their claim. And the VA ends up typically denying it because so much has happened between the time they served in the military and the time that they're actually filing their claim. I've seen that quite a bit. As I mentioned, we work only in appeals. So I'm looking at cases that are, you know, relatively difficult cases. Otherwise, if they were easy, hopefully the VA would have granted it. But one that I see a lot is that people wait to file is things related to orthopedic, back, knees, that kind of thing. Can you tell me a little bit about, from your experience, what happens when they wait that long?
Well, you know, all those situations they all kind of work in the same way, whether it's hearing, back, knees, any kind of arthritis. Things don't get better mm-hmm. because you get out of the military. Typically, time makes them move a little bit worse. So the longer we wait, the longer the time that you have between your service and the time you file, sometimes it makes it hard for the VA doctors to give a medical opinion stating whether the injury was caused or made worse by your military service. So, you know, if you have an injury, your back, and you're having problems and you were treated while on active duty, you had a diagnosis of while on active duty and you're being treated for those disabilities today, whether civilian or military, it behooves you to go ahead and file the claim.
Sure.
Because the longer we wait, the harder it is for the doctor to say whether it's a service-connected disability or not. Because a lot of stuff happens. Car accidents happen. Mm-hmm. Age happens. Just a lot of things that happened in between. And the doctor, without mere speculation, a lot of times can't say whether it's a military-related disability without just speculating that it is. And that's the problem.
Yeah, and I don't know if you experience this, but I also hear a lot from people who are getting out of the military, like, oh, you know, well, my back is not that bad, and somebody else needs it more than I do, and so it's not worth filing a claim. And I would imagine you've got the same perspective I do, that even if you file the claim, you get 0% because it's not that bad. You know, one, you've got it service-connected already, so down the road, as you mentioned, things don't typically get better when it comes to orthopedic stuff. So you've got it service-connected, and you can always get an increase if you need that down the road. And then the other thing is that, you know, you getting your disability payment is not taking away from anybody else.
Exactly. And just because you're working now and you've got a good job and you got good insurance and you don't really need the VA now, doesn't mean that you won't need them in 10 or 15 or 20 years. Or even when you retire at, you know, 65 or whatever. It behooves every veteran, if you've got a disability that you've had while on active duty, to go ahead and get it service-connected, go ahead and do the paperwork, go ahead and go through the process today, and it will help you in the long run. The biggest thing is, the way I look at it, is if you're married and you have a spouse, do it for the spouse. Do it for your family, because at the end of the day, they're the ones who ultimately could benefit from it as you get older and as you get where, hopefully not, but you get where your health, your injuries or illnesses can incapacitate you, the VA can help you a whole lot more if you're service-connected.
Yeah, definitely. And we work with a lot of veterans who get to the point that they can no longer work full-time. So you're exactly correct in that this is a benefit that supports your family, and it's kind of a responsible thing to do for your family. There are additional some benefits that, you know, could carry on to your spouse after you're gone. And so those are all things to look into. And I like that perspective of do it for your family, not just for you. One of the other interesting things that come up, we talked a little about physical stuff. And I mentioned earlier that there is no, you know, deadline date that you can, you know, if I don't file within 10 years of service, I can't file at all. There is nothing like that. You can file your claim at any period of time. But I want to address some of the like psychological disabilities. So, you know, PTSD, bipolar, depression, anxiety, that kind of thing. That can be a little bit different. I mean, it's somewhat the same. And if you wait a long time, you could have other things that actually happen to you. But in addition to that, it's a little bit different, because if you look back and say, you know, you're struggling with PTSD and all you really have to do is you showed that you had some sort of stressor, and whether that's combat or not in service, you can get that service connected. Can you speak to any of that, Todd?
I can. So if you're a combat person that served in combat, and you have PTSD and you're having issues from your service while on active duty, whether in Iraq or Vietnam or Korea, or any of the places that we send military people every day. If you have a combat action badge, CIB, Purple Heart, very easy for us to do a claim for PTSD and get you awarded PTSD. Now, the percentage is based on how bad your PTSD is, how severe your disability is. That's on any disability. But if you have those awards, Purple Heart, Combat Action Badge, Combat Infantryman's Badge, Bronze Star with Valor, any Valor award, those we don't have to have a stressor. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have one of those awards, and it's based on a stressor, a stressful event that happened while on active duty that you thought was going to cause loss of life, that you were engaged in the enemy. Mm-hmm. And that's just one, that's for PTSD. And then the post-traumatic stress that is not combat related could be training events, such as airborne and the person chute didn't open and it was your battle buddy, or you were on the drop zone when the person burned in, or accidents, car accidents, any kind of military accident. And then we have military sexual trauma, and that can be rape, any using those instances. So there's several ways that you can have PTSD while serving in the military.
Definitely.
My advice to you is...
I just want to step back a little bit because you mentioned stressors, and I want to make sure that people kind of have a clarification as to what that is. Is the when you're talking about serving in combat, you got one of those combat action awards. It's they won't ask you to say what you saw or what was the traumatic event. They will just presume that because you served in that zone, if you get a diagnosis of PTSD, that they will presume that they are linked. So that's a little bit unique if you're a combat veteran. But there are many other, as you mentioned, many other traumas that can happen that can result in post-traumatic stress. I mean, we've, you know, people who didn't even serve in the military can be diagnosed with PTSD. And some of those other things that you mentioned, including car accidents, that kind of thing. The other thing that's important is that it doesn't actually even have to be during your job at the military. It could be on your weekend off, that your weekend you went home. Just as long as you're under contract and on active duty, that you have that trauma, and then you need a current diagnosis of that.
And that's the biggest issue that we have with veterans that claim PTSD is, or any disability, current diagnosis. Just because you hurt your back while you're on active duty, just because you... you know, think you've got PTSD and you're having problems, you've got to get treatment. You have to have a diagnosis. That is the key thing that makes the VA deny people is no current diagnosis. Nobody's saying they don't believe you. It's just you hadn't started the treatment program. And that's the biggest thing that veterans get denied for is no current diagnosis.
Yeah, definitely. And the VA is supposed to, that's why they send them to a comp and pen exam. They're supposed to, if they see the in-service injury or the, combat, then they will send them to a compensation and pension exam that ask the medical professional, do they have a diagnosis? And if they do, do you think that it's related to their time in service? So you don't necessarily have to have gotten treatment before you actually file your claim. But you do ultimately have to have a diagnosis, and it would be my recommendation, and I'm guessing yours as well, Todd, that they don't wait to get the diagnosis or depend on the VA examiner to get the diagnosis unless that's the only way in which they can get it.
Correct. And you know, I tell people all the time, compensation, the money, the monthly compensation benefit, that's all well and good. But at the end of the day, we want you to be whole again. Mm-hmm. Now, I know from my experiences and my disabilities that the VA is never going to cure a lot of my issues personally. Right. But the compensation is just part of it. You have to get the treatment. Whether you go to civilian doctor or the VA, you have to get the medical care that you need to live a healthy, prosperous life. And the VA does have good programs out there to help with that. But compensation is just one part of it. Holistically, we want you to go to the VA healthcare, get good healthcare or civilian, and then do compensation and or pension claims. We want you to have the benefits you've earned if you need them.
Definitely. This is Amanda Manier with the Veterans Voice on 790 KABC. We'll be right back with Todd.
AM 790 KABC.
Voice. I am a veteran advocate and a VA disability attorney working with the Veterans Law Group. In this show on the Veterans Voice, we like to highlight not only stories about veterans, but also those who are helping veterans in various different ways. Today, we are joined by Todd. He is a U.S. Army veteran, as well as a veteran service officer of 13 years out of the state of South Carolina. And I just wanted to talk a little bit more, Todd, about getting treatment at the VA. A number of years ago, as you're probably very familiar, there was a lot of scandals that were going on about, you know, wait times at the VA and that kind of thing. And I was recently notified that there's been a new lawsuit that is claiming again that there's this scandal that's brewing with the VA patient wait times. I know that that's very, you know, region specific, where, you know, one thing can be happening in South Carolina that's not happening in California that is happening in Denver. But I was just wondering if you had any sort of knowledge or anything that was going on over there.
Well, I have a great relationship with our partners at the VA medical centers. And one thing to remember, the VA medical centers across the nation, VA healthcare in general, is the largest healthcare provider in the world. Mm-hmm. There's not a bigger organization that takes care of people's healthcare in the world. So that's a complicated mechanism just to comprehend. But sure. My advice to anybody would be go to your local county Veterans Affairs officer, if you have one, and enroll in VA healthcare. Now, there is a system, and it is a system, you have to learn it. Mm-hmm. And once you learn how to navigate the system, and people like myself can help you with that, the VA is a wonderful place to get healthcare. It's not perfect, but I don't really believe that there's a civilian healthcare program out there that's as perfect either.
Sure.
The VA in general, I get all my care from it, and I'm as probably as messed up as anybody out there. I just told everybody on the radio that I am, but you know, they really take care of me, and I feel really blessed that I have the VA to use, and I get all my care from VA.
That's really great to hear, because you definitely hear, you know, all kinds of perspectives on that. That some people that hate the VA and they've, you know, had horrible service there, and you've had others who, like, just like you and my uncle, who is a Vietnam veteran, he gets all of his care through the VA, and he thinks it's been a huge help for him. One of the things you just mentioned. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, again, the VA is never going to satisfy everybody, and it's mm-hmm. just like going to McDonald's. You're not always going to get your hamburger the way you want it, mm-hmm. and that's no different in healthcare. You're going to have difficulties with appointment times. Doctors go on vacation. You know, mm-hmm. Things are not always the way we want it, but and are not as quick as we want it. But in general, VA has really good health care. And if you talk to the right people, if you have issues with the VA, instead of telling your neighbor, you know, I'm not happy with my care, go and talk to a social worker. And if they don't mm-hmm. give you the right answer, go to a veterans advocate and talk to them. And if you don't get the right answer from them, go to the director's office themselves and talk to the director. I've never met a VA director at a hospital system that did not want to hear from their veterans to try to make their things better. And that doesn't mean that they're going to go over and give you what you want if it's out of the realm, but they do care. Yeah. I really believe that.
Definitely. That's great to hear. One of the things I was going to ask you about is, one of the pieces of advice that I generally give, and when people ask me, like, what are the top three pieces of advice you would give to a veteran who's going through this process? The number one is always don't do it alone. Don't go it alone. And whether or not you work with a veteran service officer, or, you know, if on appeal, an attorney, it's so important not to try to navigate this process on your own. When you work with a veteran service officer like Todd, he's going to not only know this because he's done it hundreds, if not thousands of times, he knows that it's A plus B plus C equals compensation. Those three things that Todd mentioned earlier on in this call. In addition to that, one of the things that I've learned as I've worked for years doing webinars and education and meeting with veteran service officers all across the country is the reason why I love the county veteran service officers is you guys don't just know about VA disability claim. You know about veteran services in general in your county. So being able to, you know, help them with, you know, if they're dealing with housing, or just like you said, help direct them to the social worker who might be able to help them. What other kinds of things do you help veterans with that maybe is outside of the VA or outside of maybe what a veteran would be thinking about what you do?
Well, that's a great question. I happen to be in a small county in South Carolina. And so we don't have a lot of the issues that a larger community may have, but we work with the community. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a lot of resources within your community. you know, America Warrior Partnership is a national program that has a program that they communicate back and forth with other entities and try to help veterans get maybe a refrigerator that's broken, mm-hmm. or if they need an air condition fix, just those things, not counting, you know, working with American Red Cross or Salvation Army to get food for the veteran or family. Mm-hmm. But mostly, you know, just trying to make those connections and finding out what the community offers, not only veterans, but just people in general. But there are some specific organizations that give specifically for veterans, and that may be power, water assistance, or rent assistance. It really depends on the county you live in or the city you live in, to what resources may be available.
Yeah, definitely. And you guys being right there on the ground that know your community resources, it kind of gives a different perspective than if you were dealing with like a national organization, which is one of the reasons I love working with you guys. You're listening to KABC. You're listening to the Veterans Voice on KABC. I'm speaking with Todd, who is a U.S. Army veteran and a veteran service officer. And we're just talking about generally some of the things that he does as far as helping veterans get local resources, help them get help at the VA. Go ahead, Todd. Sorry to interrupt you.
No, I was going to say, if you know someone that's a veteran or you're a veteran in need and you may need assistance with, you know, food or rent or whatever it may be, and you have a county VA officer in your community, reach out to those guys first, because mm-hmm. 9 times out of 10, they already have made the relationship. They've already built a relationship with the community partners. And instead of trying to go individually to those organizations, work through your VA rep at your county mm-hmm. level, and they can help vet the need, and they can a lot of times unlock a lot of doors and barriers that and make it seamless instead of having to jump through some things that you normally wouldn't have to jump through.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, I get asked a lot about like how I ended up working in this area of law. I had worked for about 10 years as a business attorney and never even knew that this was an area of law that I could work in. I've always had a huge respect for the military, and my mom kind of raised me with that perspective. And how I doing this is I had a friend of mine who spent about 18 months in Iraq and came back with struggling with PTSD and struggling with being able to hold down a job or go to school. And he was trying to do it on his own. He had filed the claims on his own. And, you know, ultimately he got, you know, proposed to be incompetent, not handle his finances, which was never an issue of his. And I, as somebody who represented other people as an advocate, it got to be very frustrating every time he would tell me a story. And I, you know, at that point, I didn't know about veteran service officers, and he didn't even know about veteran service officers, which was interesting. You know, how does that information really get posed or taught to veterans? And maybe you can speak to that, Todd. Like, how do people find out about county veteran service officers?
Well, you know, I can only speak to my state. We have a county VA officer in every state. Now, I know Arizona don't have many, and certain, and there's California certainly has them. Mm-hmm. I've got several friends in California. Hopefully all of your listeners has a county VA officer.
So when people are getting out of the military, are they told about veteran service officers? Like we were talking about the class that they go through, that's, you know, the zero benefits, all of that kind of thing. Or do you, as a veteran service officer, do outreach to people as they're transitioning, anything like that?
No, we don't. We do the outreach in the community. Mm-hmm. The military doesn't do a good job with saying, hey, you have a county VA officer in your state. That they basically have a VA rep at the classes that we spoke about, and they do your claim on the spot, and, you know, and you get a letter in the mail to your home or record and saying this is what your rating is. Mm-hmm. So, no, they don't do a really good job. So the best thing we can do is word of mouth. You know, mm-hmm. the listeners out there today know that, hey, we're here. We don't charge a dime. It's free. It's a free service. I want to really interact that, because there's some people out there and organizations out there that charge to do what we do. There's nobody more successful than with the county VA officers in your communities. And we do not charge any fees to help you. And and that's a big thing for us, because you've earned these benefits and you shouldn't have to pay to sit down with someone to help you. But again, you know, the military doesn't really assist and tell you, hey, you know, you got someone like Todd in your community, or Amanda in your community. You have to find that out the hard way. But that's why we're here trying to bring light to the subject, because there are a lot of us around the nation.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're going to come back here in a minute, and I want to dig into a little bit more about what you would need to do when you do need additional help, and reiterate kind of what Todd had said about the free service. You're listening to The Veteran's Voice on KABC Los Angeles. We're speaking with Todd, who is a U.S. Army veteran and a veteran service officer from South Carolina for the past 13 years. And one of the reasons why I wanted to have Todd on, not only to be able to speak to services that are offered by the VA, but also kind of just what we were just talking about in the last segment of veteran service officers that are there in your local community. They not only know how to help veteran navigate the process at the VA, also the VA Healthcare Center, but also additional resources in the area that can help if you're, you know, needing assistance with rent or AC fixed or all that kind of thing. Here in Southern California, as Todd had mentioned, we do have county veteran service officers in every county. We also have a state organization called CalVet who has veteran service officers that help. And, you know, it's a little bit hit and miss. There are definitely really, really great veteran service officers, and there are also people that we hear complaints about as well. And I'm not going to mention any names, but Todd certainly isn't one of them. One of the things that I've known is Todd and his team, everybody that I've met in South Carolina, they truly care about what they're doing. And as Todd had mentioned, that they offer services at no cost. You are an employee of the county, correct, Todd?
Yes, ma'am, I am.
Okay, so you're effectively, you know, paid through taxpayer money, that kind of thing. But it's an ability, most counties set up a veteran particular office that helps support military and veteran families. And what's the name of it in South Carolina?
Well, we have the South Carolina Department of Veterans Affairs. That's the government agency that oversees the county Veterans Affairs officers. But every county Veterans Affairs officer works independently in the county for the county.
Okay, great. And what I love about the ability of you guys being able to represent the veterans, were before we went on break, you were talking about how when the VA goes out to like transitioning military, they're going to have somebody that works for the VA that helps you fill out paperwork and files it for you. But they aren't truly your representative. Is that right?
That's correct. They're there to push the paper. So if you come to my office, and you're all welcome, if you really want to make the trek, but we'll definitely help you. I'm here to make you successful with the VA process. That's my job. Mm-hmm. And it's really to break it down to where you can understand it and to where you understand the process. Because the VA, with any federal government, whether it's IRS, VA, or any other, they make it very complicated. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying they make it to where you want to give up and quit, but they do make it very where the average person doesn't understand the process. So that's our job. Sure. And she said, Amanda said earlier, that not every county Veterans Affairs officer or service officer is as proficient as the other. Then, you know, if you do not think that you're getting the care or service that you need, you need to move on to another.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. And I would probably say the same thing you were saying about the healthcare, is that if you're in an office that you're not getting good care, their supervisor probably would like to hear about that.
Yes. I mean, that's where your social worker comes in. Just because you don't like the doctor that you're seeing at the VA, all you have to do is put in for a change of provider form and go to a different provider. Now, again, you have to learn the system, and that's what our job is to help you navigate the system as easy as possible and answer those questions that probably are not easy answered through the VA. They're going to give you the bureaucratic answer, you know, the government answer. We're going to break it down simple for you and be honest with you. I mean, because we have nothing to gain. Again, we don't get paid, you know, extra because you get service connected or whatever. My biggest advice for any veteran out there that believes that they have earned more or deserve more or whatever is don't quit. Do their appeals process, work with VLG, Veterans Law Group, or work with your county VA officer, and do not quit, because I'm living proof to someone who doesn't stop and doesn't quit. And I feel like, you know, that's the reason I've been successful with the VA personally, and I've been successful with other veterans that I've represented that have gotten what they've earned. It's because we didn't quit. But we also worked on the evidence. We also worked on getting the nexus letters. And, you know, we also worked on what we needed to be successful with the VA. And that's what our job is.
Yeah, I always tell people that my job is to make it very easy for the VA to grant a case, put all the ducks in a row, make it simple. And so often I even pull back and I tell, okay, don't overload the VA with 4,000 pages of medical records from your private physician when what they really need is the 4 pages on page 1,000 to 1,004. And so there's, you know, some of that like strategy going on.
Yeah, I mean, the more you give them, the more that can be missed. I'll stick, keep it as simple as possible, keep it to the point, make very clear arguments, and I mean, it can be navigated. And I'm seeing more claims are being processed today than any other time in the nation's history. More claims are being granted today than any other time. I'm seeing some things that I didn't see 10 years ago being granted. So I think we're in the right track, but a lot of veterans have already given up. So please don't give up.
Yeah, definitely. And I hear that a lot of, you know, that they, you know, do that when we take cases on contingency. So I kind of want to address that, because when you're initially filing a claim, working with a veteran service officer, nobody can charge a fee to a veteran for filing those initial claims. So there are companies out there that charge these consulting fees and all this other stuff, which drives me crazy. So when it comes to pursuing working with an attorney like our office, like I mentioned earlier, we are typically handling the more difficult cases, the ones that need, you know, research and money put into independent exams and all of that kind of thing, or they're just really hard cases. So I refer to veteran service officers all the time to say, hey, you know, you don't need us yet. Go talk with somebody like Todd to help file your claim. And in response to that, building good relationships with veteran service officers, sometimes they recognize, you know what, you're probably going to need an attorney on this case, and send them our way. Todd, do you have any sort of example of one that you would say, you need an attorney on this, and you would send them our office or somebody else in your local area?
Well, I mean, it's really case by case, Amanda. I mean, when we've exalted every issue, I mean, the thing is, I don't recommend an attorney till I've done everything I can do. And that's even going to BBA. When it's went through the appeals process from maybe a supplemental or a higher level review, the thing is, they're going to give you a statement of case, and they're going to tell you exactly what you need to be successful. It's in black and white. This is why we denied you. This is why we couldn't give it to you. If we can give it to them, then we won. If you can't give it to them, then we need to back up and punt. So it's very simple, but I do it every day, so it's very simple for me. But we work with the veteran to make sure, to see if we can get the evidence to be successful. And sometimes we can't, sometimes we can't. But I will say, I had a veteran that was a 30-year Army officer, a full bird colonel, and he was Special Forces, done 4 tours in Vietnam. And when he retired out of the military, I don't know what happened, but the guy's, you know, up in age now, and he's filed a claim, and the VA denied it and said, we can't find your military records. So he says, I did 30 years in the Army, and you can't find my records. You know, the VA lost my records. I said, well, whether the VA lost them, or the typically the VA don't lose them, because they get them from the Army or the DOD. But they could be in someone else's file. So I've seen this before, and I'm sure Amanda has, where files get misplaced or put under the same person's name, but it may not be the same person. But there's a lot of Todd Humphreys out there, or John Doe's, or Jim Smith's, or whoever. But and they get put in the wrong file. But we didn't quit with this guy. And his buddy statements, his statements that the reason he was injured and had the disability, was factual statements that we could back up from his MOSs and his awards and what he could show. And when it finally went to the BBA, the law judge granted the guy his 100% disability because of everything added up, and it made sense, and it was collaborated to a point that the law judge felt very certain that the guy was telling the truth, and he could back up enough of it to give him his disability.
It doesn't happen like that all the time, but it
can happen.
Yeah, definitely. A lot of the cases that we end up coming to us because, like, they've, you know, exhausted, just like you said, worked with their veteran service officer, exhausted everything that they could do. I often say this to the founder of Veterans Law Group, who's been doing this for 25 years, and he still looks at cases and he's like, that one's going to be hard to prove. It's like, so let him go to the judge and tell his story. You know, that's what's it going to hurt to put him before a judge and put him under oath? Let him tell his story, because the whole, like, lack of evidence doesn't mean that it didn't happen.
Exactly. And that's why I say don't quit. Let it go all the way through the process. And then if we still think we can win, we'll go with an organization like VLG. But there's, you know, a lot of people just get disgusted and quit the process before really giving it a chance. And you know, the VA makes mistakes just like any other organization. But we can help you work through it.
Yeah, and I really appreciate that. And I know that one of the things that, you know, I'm constantly telling people is, because we work on a contingency basis, so if you come to a law firm like ours and it's on contingency, which just means that we don't get paid unless you get paid. We get your lump sum of back pay. We end up getting a percentage of that. And one of the nice things about that is I can regularly, and I'm sure even Todd, not even dealing with this, of like, you're their representative, you're regularly encouraging them not to give up. You know, let us handle it. Your paperwork's going to come to us. You know, we can walk you through this process. Just go about your life and we'll let you know when we need something. And it's, you know, and it's an honor to work with veterans every day and to help them get what they need. And I'm sure that you feel the same way, Todd. Yeah,
it is. I mean, and being a veteran myself, sometimes I forget that I am a veteran, but there's no greater job that I've ever had than serving others. Now I'm not saying it's easy, and I'm not saying that every veteran should get what they're claiming, but we're there to help them and give them honest opinions, honest consideration and advice to being successful. And I'll tell you, if I think it can be successful, not doesn't mean that we won't still file the claim or we still won't do the appeal. But I'll tell you how hard it's going to be and how long it's going to be. But if you're willing to fight, I'm willing to stand there beside you. And that's what matters, is finding someone who's willing to stand there beside you for the long haul.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Todd. We're coming up against a hard break. Thank you so much for being here. This is Amanda Manier with the Veterans Voice on KABC 790.